Sahira, just to recapitulate what we were discussing last week, Swami had introduced the concept of Varnas, and I think where we left off was if there's competition among the Varnas, it'll be like the limbs fighting among themselves and thinking that the head is bigger, hands are bigger, and things like that. I think that's where we were. I think we will continue to read what we discussed because we read it and we left it. We did not start the discussion. So I will ask the sisters to read and we'll continue from where we left off.
So yeah, the four Varnas are like the limbs of the same body. They have evolved out of the same divine body. The Brahmins from the face, Kshatriyas from the hands, the Vaishyas from the thighs, and the Sudras from the feet. Of course, these expressions are a deeper inner meaning. Those who teach like the Guru, the principles of Jnana, are the boys. They are the Brahmins. The strong-armed bear the burden of the earth. They are the Kshatriyas. The social edifice is upheld as on pillars by the Vaishyas, and so they are figuratively described as the emanating from the thighs of the divine person. Like the feet that are engaged in going about on all kinds of activities, the Sudras are ever engaged in the basic task of society. The peace and happiness of the society will suffer even if a single Varna is slack in its task. And all Varnas are worthwhile and valuable as all limbs are important. There's no higher or lower. Hatred and rivalry in society are as harmful as the stoppage of work by all the limbs in anger against the stomach.
Thank you, Sister Narmada. There's nothing much for me to add, and we can discuss. In the meantime, I had also sent to Sister Kalyani the description of the Varnas in Dharma Vahini, so that also can be discussed. But maybe I will just open it up for discussion for now, and then maybe if there is interest, we can look at the descriptions of the Varnas from Dharma Vahini. Saira, I will open it up for the discussion, and anyone can share what any thought you have based on what Swami has said here. Saira.
Saram, I do have a comment or a question. So based on this four Varnas, right? So the Brahmins, the teachers, Kshatriyas would be the warriors or the army or police in that sense, right? And Vaishyas would be any businessman. So any other profession comes under sutra, correct? If you think of it that way, like any work that you do. Let's say doctors, nurses, or farmers, or anything, those category, they come under sudras then, correct?
I think you're listing a few professions.
Yes, if you think
yeah,
about.
So anyone related to, you had mentioned farmers. Farmers actually fall under Vaishyas.
Oh, okay.
People who, because they are part of commerce,
okay,
they produce something. Generally, sudras are, the service industry is sudras. even manufacturing would come under, if a person in the industrialist or manufacturing industry is part of Vaishya tradition. But the sudras may be helping in every other group because they provide services. So this is my understanding.
Okay, I was trying to put it in the common terms, practical yes. purposes. Thank you.
Sai Ram, normally the my understanding, the farmers the go under the sutras because normally when they categorize the business people, they would categorize the whoever do the business. For farmers also they could do the business, but up until today I thought farmers fall under the sutras, but that's a very new point I learned today, that farmers go under the business category. The
so that's my understanding, but I think if maybe we should read the Dharma Vahini, what Sister Kalyani, I don't know if she has it available on us. Okay, so I think we can read. I think Sister Narmada, you can read.
Sure. The traits of the castes. Brahmins are known by their significant traits, knowledge, vidya, virtue, action of the most exalted and beneficial kind, and the spread of virtue by example. One who promotes these and cultivates these and develops these in a Brahmin, whoever one is. That is the qualification and the authority exercisable by the Brahmin. Only the highly learned person and the person who conducts themselves as befits that learning can deserve this status. Learning this qualification is the effort to be made by those eager to justify that position. Now for the signs of protectors, Kshatriyas. They are efficient in all undertakings, have heroism, courage, adventure, and an eagerness to punish the wicked and protect the virtuous. Those endued with such qualities are entitled to the status of warriorhood. They have to take up all tasks with that attitude and establish at home worthy rules for all. Next, the business people, Vaishyas. They have to try to make the currents of commerce flow smooth and fast, to forge communication links that tie the nations into the commonwealth and make wealth multiply in the world. That is their task. They must ensure that the concord between people is unbroken and undiminished. They have to aspire for the fame, yashas, of great deeds and noble achievements, and the splendor, varaksha, of having helped in the spread of education and health by the erection of schools, hospitals, and the like. They must devote their wealth to the promotion of all worthy causes. By this means, virtue and righteousness are fostered.
I think the next one also, yeah.
Okay. Now for the laborers, sudras, and their ideal characteristics. They have to produce and gather things of value, not deviating from the path of Dharma. Always earnest to realize the objects of human existence and always striving for the same. They must intelligently store and protect things produced, try to produce more and more for the common good. The things that collected have to be literally utilized for the spread of genuine knowledge, vidya, and for the sustenance and support of the right virtuous. In this way, by cooperative effort of these four types of human endeavor, wealth will become much and manifold. Man will be rendered happy. The four castes, varnas, have to feel that the social order has been designed with the overall aim of maintaining world dharma. Loka Dharma. If each caste adheres to its duties, the welfare of the world will double doubtless be assured. Besides, each will be able to win what is even more important, the bliss of the Atma. On the other hand, if all feel that there is but one caste, one code of duties, and one set of rules for all, the welfare and security of the world will be endangered. If all enter the field of trade, who will purchase the purchase and consume the goods for offered? If all starts teaching, who will learn and practice? If all command, who will obey? If all produce and grow, who will seek the products of their toil? It is to create the diversity that will contribute to the unity through the practice of truth and dharma in every individual and social act that the Lord has obtained the way of living according to the duty of caste, varna dharma.
Okay, yeah, continue, please.
It is believed that occupation, vritti, was based on the caste, varna. No castes were so named on the basis of the occupations only. Today, there is neither caste or occupation. One profession today, another tomorrow. A caste today, another tomorrow. This instability lies at the root of the disturbed atmosphere of the world, of the discontent that has spread. Infuse every profession and occupation with inner morality, with constant attachment to truth, with the unperturbed equanimity of fortitude, then follow the duties of the caste, varna, with its prescribed professions. That is the summum bonum, the supreme blessing. If you fail to do this, your lot will be misery and chronic poverty. The choice is between the first, the Sri Rama savior, Raksha, and the second, the worldly punishment, loka shiksha, of distressed, Durbhiksha. Your savior of punishment is learning dharma shikshana.
So I think we read through quite a bit of material. If people want, we can discuss each one separately. The translation has called it caste, and that word caste can always make it a bit of a problem, because caste is an English word and it may not necessarily translate varna, because caste is considered kula, whereas varna is a bit more a broader brush. And so those are my comments, but if anyone would like to discuss this, because we are discussing varnas, I thought it may be relevant to see something a bit more detailed from what Swami has written. So I'll open it up for discussion or any comments, what others would like to discuss, and then we can proceed. Sahil.
Sorry, what is kula?
So kula is a subdivision of a varna. Okay. For example, if you take a simple one, is to go to, let's take the Shudras. So they are all tradespeople. They are, you know, providers of service. So, but if when they provide a service, then you can have goldsmiths, or you can have ironsmiths. You know, they become a slightly subset of, within a varna, and that becomes caste in generally. That's the way it's used in India. In Bharat, so varna is a general, a broad brush of division, four varnas. But within varna, there can be castes, or, you know, certain lineages which produce a particular trade or something like that. Okay, so that's, even there are, even if you take Kshatriya, there are different people who specialize in different aspects of governing. There can be kings, then there can be generals, armed forces, and things like that. So everyone is, there's subcategories. So that's why I said caste is a bit more narrower definition than varna. Varna is it's a color or the flavor of a particular group of people. Okay, so that's my understanding. And I think I will also comment, I think Sister Anandi was talking about farmers. So for example, if you take a farm, if you are an if you're an agriculturalist, you are in the you own land and you produce rice or other grains or vegetables or fruits and so on. But then you will employ people to come and help you with that work. And there will be a laborer, so, you know, people who's who come and provide a service. And they would be under, so there is a cooperative effort among the Varnas also. So I thought I would just mention that. So, but everyone may say, I'm a farmer, you know. Generally a farmer, agricultural means one who has agricultural land and who oversees the production of crops and so on. Whereas there can be others who provide services to that farmer. Okay, but so there's, it's a very difficult definition.
Thank you, brother. I just wanted to share with yesterday or Friday, we always think farmers are normal tendency. When we say someone farmer, we always think they are in the not in the richer side, they would be in the poorer side or maybe in the middle class side. That is our normal perception or tendency to think. So if I say I am a farmer, that would be the others. But in my office, the one of the other department's colleagues, she, I am in the farm, the farmland. I am a farm girl, and then she described all the farmers in that area as multi-billionaires. You know, the you can't even see the their, you know, the properties and the way of they are living. That's why normally when we say farming, whether do you have any normal, the Tim Hortons, this and that, and she was laughing, why do we need Tim Horton? We, every house, we have the dairy and everything. Also, very all other high-end facilities too. That's why we all thought, when we say farmers, we always think that very remote and, they don't have much facilities, this and that. But it could be in the opposite side too. They would be a very well-off business people too. I agree. Thank you, brother.
If there's no comment, I think, can we go to the last slide on this, actually? I think that's what's more important, I think. Okay. So here again, Swami is talking about, people jumping from one type of job to another job, one type of, profession to another. And Swami says this creates confusion in the society. I think that's the first thing. And then he says, we had to follow the duties of the Varna, which is prescribed with its prescribed professions. And that's a blessing. Okay, if you fail to do this, your lot will be misery and chronic poverty. The choice is between the first Sri Rama Raksha or the Loka Siksha. So, whether it's you want protection of Rama or you want the punishment of the world, Loka Siksha. And because of that, you will get what Swami says is Durbhiksha. So which is distress. That will be the lot we earn. And Swami says, the how to get out of that situation is Dharma Sikshana, to learn Dharma. Which is what Krishna is more or less summarizing to Arjuna, or Swami is summarizing for our purposes in the Gita Vahini. I thought I would just point that out.
Sairavana, I think the previous slide where Swami is saying that, and if we all feel that there is but one caste, the one code of duties, and there's an issue, right? is society will be endangered. But Swami also at one point, I think in one of the quotes said there's, you know, one caste of humanity, or so I am trying to understand the difference here.
A very nice question. You know, these are, there are quotations people, you know, say there's only one religion, religion of love. There's only one language, language of the heart. You know, this Swami has this quotation. And people say, don't practice our religion. You know, everyone is of the same religion. It is not the same. See, when Swami makes that statement, we all should understand that there are distinctions. See, now we are speaking English. If I do not speak English and I just mumble something and tell, you know, this is the language of the heart, understand what I'm saying. Will you understand? You will not understand. So the thing is, English as a language is needed, and it will be there, and it has its own grammar. And we have to follow that grammar so that we can speak English, so we can communicate. So a superficial understanding of Swami's quotes is great damage to the anti-Satya-Sai organization. Unfortunately, very unfortunate. So the thing is, then we should all say, okay, let's find what's the language of heart, only speak that and drop all the languages. It is not possible. The world will run. But we should understand, underlying all that, there's a heart. Everything we speak, whichever language you speak, should come from the heart. Whichever religion you practice, you should never give up love. So if you think there's only one caste, means in all castes, humanity should be present. Otherwise, it is you are losing the essence of that essence. The essence of everything is humanity. So whether you are a Brahmana or whether a Kshatriya, don't lose your humanness. That is the meaning of that quote. Not abolish all castes, now we are all same. No, it is not. It'll just confusion. I think that's what Swami is saying. So sometimes to study each of Swami's quotes is a lifetime thing. to read all his discourses, then we will understand. I think that's my understanding. Yes, Brother Thasan.
Yes, I remember. It's a very nice question too. I'd like to add to your point, brother. So one caste, just one humanity. Even Varnas, we have four Varnas. Swami nicely explained, you can compare to some parts of your body, head or leg. So everything is going to do their part of the work. But the leg cannot do hands work. So everyone's supposed to do whatever they have allocated. Then only we can do the work and we can keep the country going very smoothly. But whenever you do the work, if you do without the ego and I, you can achieve that task and you are not caught into the that ego problem. So even Swami, one more thing he's explaining about the toy chocolate. Wherever you taste, even head part or leg or hand, all same sweet. So you cannot differentiate. So the humanity is same. Thank you, Sairam.
Thank you very much, brother. Any other thought from anyone, please?
Brother, yeah. Sairam, brother, is it possible for you to switch to the slide where Swami says in danger when you switch the Varnas, kind of that the last sentence, please? Because that means right now we are really sutras or Vaishnavas and like farmers, we are working like this. So that is something. So which dharma, which varnas, kind of question, right? So that's why I wanted to read that and understand that sentence more. Thank you, Sarah.
I'll open it up for, you know, I think the question is because of, you know, the way the world is structured today and the types of profession and occupation that we have, we don't know what is our Varna. You know, I think that's your question. And then what to do? And you know, should we change something?
Yeah, really, we are not practicing which Varna we are born. So I wanted to understand that sentence from Swami, what is really saying to us. Thank you, Sairam.
Thank you very much, sister. So I will not give an, I will not speak at this point. I will ask others to share, but I seem to be the only one speaking today. So I will open it up for discussion. But so what, I think sister's question is, how do we determine what Varna we are in? And how do we function so that we do not go against what Swami has taught here? I think that's her question. So I will open it up. So do we start investigating what our Varna is? Should we change what we are doing today so that we will align with what Swami says? So I think this is a question which is going to stem when, if, I think last week, Sister Vijaya was asking the same question. You know, I'm a Kshatriya, now I'm a doctor, you know, what am I to do? You know, things like that. So those are the questions. So I will open it up for participants to share their thoughts.
It kind of gets confusing, I think, current stage too. Like if you think about it, like you mentioned, for farmers, for example, I always thought they were sutras, right? Because, and even like you mentioned, in the farmers, in that category, you have different levels as well, in a sense. Farmers who actually get in the field and do the farming job, there's one. And then who are actually trading the crops, and then that is more of a Vaishya kind of sense. And then there's somebody actually planning the strategies as to how, where to market and things like that. I don't know where that falls under correctly, right? Similar to where I am in the pharmaceutical industry, you know, there are actual scientists who are doing the work for the wet lab, they're doing, performing that, and someone who is actually managing it, like who I am in that area, like, you know, things like that. So in that profession, like, you know, if you move to a different department, your I think Varna or your the type of job that you changes from a scientist to a business person or the strategist. So is that also forbidden? So how do you, like, I guess I'm thinking in that sense, like, so I'll just put that out there.
Okay, thank you.
So
Narmada, you are also just asking the question.
Yes.
Sorry,
I'm adding to the pot.
Okay, so go ahead, Kalyani.
No, I was just actually going to add another question, which I think is related about, like, how do you determine what is your Varna? Because in some of the, I know it's supposed to be by birth, but like in some of the stories, there are people born in the same family, but they are different. Sage Vyasa, and then through the same mother, there's kings that are born. Like, so how do you, like, what is it? Is it the mother that determines or the father? But then in the case of Ravana, his father was a sage, but he was a Kshatriya. So what is it? Is it really the birth, or is there some other way to determine what is your Varna?
Okay, good. Thank you. So it's, questions are building up more than any thought. I will open it. Yes, Brother Asan, you want to say something?
So if we take Brahmins, everyone knows by birth they are Brahmins. So if the Brahmins supposed to do their work nowadays, they are doing Vaisava job, the reason is the money. Even most of the Brahmins nowadays, they are doing full-time job. As a part-time only, they are doing the Brahmins work. So they don't have enough time to memorize the mantra. They don't have enough time to do the three kala puja, and they cannot educate the people that walk in a good path, good citizens. So this is a good example I can talk about. They are born as a Brahmins, so they're supposed to do their work. Nowadays they are not doing that one. Thank you, Sairam brother.
Okay, thank you, brother.
Sairam,
yes,
the I'm not sure Yili, I am the answering the question, but Yili, I thought in my mind we all understand all four castes or the varnas are similar to four different parts of the body. We all know that even without one part we cannot fully function, Yili. And even even though we know all of those, till up until now or today, we don't appreciate each other's profession or job, what they are doing in the other varnas or in the caste system. We always think that, okay, who is the better one? Why we are in the lower level? Why they are in the upper level? We don't have that thought or the positive side of, we never thought of, we all are equal, and we really work hand in hand to perform some task we have assigned to in this birth. Why that sort of thinking we always lacking? Because by birth we are thinking that we are in the lower caste, they are in the upper caste, or we are in the upper caste, they are in the middle caste. What is the rational or reasoning? We always take this caste system or varna system as a big thing. Swami has given so many other teachings. We never take those as serious as this one. Whenever this topic comes in, we always think that why it should be like this, why it should be like that. Maybe some sort of our mental thought process, it's not really in the spiritual way. Otherwise, if Swami has already clearly said that all are equal, without even one single part, we cannot perform anything. That's why there is no higher, no lower. But still, even today, tomorrow, even 100 years after, this topic will be evergreen. Some sort of the fundamental the problem in this particular subject matter. Thank you, Sairam.
Sairam, sister, thank you.
Sairam, sister, Sairam, brother Arun.
Yes, auntie.
Sairam. I think it's the inferiority complex, the complex feeling that we are lower and somebody is higher. That is making us feel this casteism so overburdened with all the things. I feel so, Sairam.
Thank you very much, auntie. Yes, sister Vijaya, please go ahead.
Sairam, brothers and sisters, thank you. I think it was Sister Narmata who said this, so Sister Kalyani, that last paragraph there, the two paragraphs, this last slide, these days you have people changing occupations. They may, even as doctors, have worked in hospitals, I worked in research universities, and now I'm doing my own private practice. You go from the profession, but what the dharma of that profession you're doing, wherever places of work is different from the dharma. Dharma doesn't change. I'm about, helping people, to help themselves. So I think it's the dharma that, so when I don't do that dharma, Swami says, I have distress. I have the loka shiksha and the durbiksha. I know my calling. And if you don't do according to that, you have to look into yourself. I don't think it is, the varna system may be there, may be born into whatever caste, but ultimately, I think it's the profession and occupation you have to do with inner morality and constant attachment to truth. So I have it many times. I own companies, and when I've been told to sell my products to the large corporations, you know, very, very large, and they'll give you lots of money, for example, but they're going to use very dangerous ingredients. And as there, the meeting, and you know, I had to stop it. I didn't know how to stop it because we were already far into the discussion. We're going to sign the papers, and I was giving my product away to this major distributors. And it happened many, many times. And Swami puts you on the spot. And that's where the human values and the Dharma comes in. This, how do you attach yourself to the truth? Because I have to pray to Swami. I say, Swami, I'm supposed to sign these papers because I'm the CEO of the company, but this is a wrong thing I'm doing for my patients or my clients and whoever's going to buy this product, because they're going to use, they already tell me now to my face, you're going to use an inferior genetically modified ingredient. And in my profession, that's a no-no for people who are very, very sick, that these products are false. So it's, I'm just giving an example where the test is. And if you go straight to Baba at that time and just do Namasmarana, Swami sent in immediately somebody, didn't even look like that person, you know, like, anyway, he will send the help you need when you stick to the truth. And sometimes it's a very, very, very tough situation, as I'm sure all of us on this call, you've had questions like that, you know, whether you're a teacher or a doctor or a professional or your business owner, you will be sorely tested on your value system. And that's not to make us bad or anything, but for us to understand there are many nuances to this truth. And if you're caught in a bind, you have to call on Swami so that you can have unperturbed equanimity of fortitude. You know, and then you follow the rules and what you have to do. And it's an amazing flowering of your values, your dharma, and how to grow spiritually, I feel. So, and I've had relatives, you know, who have been given all the education and everything. And in the end, they want to become, a musician. Their heart is into music. So it's and they do well with the music because they have their talents and all that. So it doesn't mean anything. It's like, you know, as you go through life, you feel you'll honor your profession, what you want to do. I don't think you can be born in a caste system, and you find that adherence to truth and dharma, it's an individual choice, and the profession, they will have the morality of the profession. So if we didn't have these discussions and Swami's writing in the Gita Vahini and the Dharma Vahini, nobody would know. That's why Auntie Mani was saying, you know, it's confusion. It's no clarification. So the question that I have is, we can practice it individually, but Swami is looking at a higher perspective. The 20,000 feet, he's looking at, you know, where are my people? You know, what are they doing? So I have no answer for that. How do you look at it from 20,000 feet? Who am I to make noise? I can just stand up for what I believe in, and, you know, I'm not going to do bad things to my patients or my clients. Then ask Swami, please, because we don't know what rule Swami is using. What is his ruler? What is his measurement? Sairam, thank you.
Sairam, sister Sairam. Yes, Brother Dasan, you wanted to say something.
Okay. Yes, Sairam, brother. According to the sister Vijaya, we cannot change the dharma. For an example, if we take Brahmin and Sutra, so we take as a Brahmin is a hand, and Sutra we take as a leg. So that hand supposed to do whatever according to the dharma. The leg has to do according to the dharma. We cannot switch it. If we try to switch it, it's going to be against to the nature. So whoever born on that caste or varna, so they have to live according to the dharma. Dharma is defined. Thank you, Sairam.
Sairam, brother Sairam. Yes, Sister Aruna, please go ahead.
Hi, Ram, brother. After Sister Vijaya is bringing out every time to call out to Swami for any time in dilemma, I think you can switch any caste, anything that you want, as long as you follow your Atma Dharma and call out to Swami. That's what I thought after discussion. So I just thought to share it. Thank you, Saira.
So anyway, lots of inputs. I will just share my thoughts. I think Swami has identified that we are living in a disturbed atmosphere. Swami has acknowledged that. And Swami also has made a statement in the Gita Vahini that the Varna system was a blessing which was granted to Bharat. Whereas in other countries, it is not present. The reality is that many of us who have taken to, even though we are from Bharat or, you know, Bharat aligned countries where Bharati culture was there, we were influenced quite a bit by Western education. So in that sense, we are living abroad, whether we are in those countries or we are living abroad. So I think the question for us is, what is our role in this? Because we cannot change the world. We cannot determine what other people's varnas are. We have to all think for ourselves and do what we can in the best way possible. I think from what Swami has said, by the way, we are in a every one of us is in a profession today. And I think what Swami says is don't change profession. That statement is coming through. I think that at least that much we can do. We cannot increase the confusion in the world. That we could do. And I think that way, whether by accident or by circumstances, by our own choices, we have landed somewhere. Then Swami says, don't create more confusion for yourself. And if by not creating for yourself, you don't create for others, number one. Number two, the second thing which we can do is, if anyone who is fortunate to be born in a Varna and they are following their Varna, we should do everything possible to support them so that they do not create additional confusion. Like, for example, if a Brahmana is completely 100% dedicated to his profession, support them. If a businessman is doing good business, support them. Because all of us in our own way also support the society. So we should not be selfish. We should, you know, we should be able to go out of our way to support them so that there is no confusion. You know, for example, even if somebody is running a business and the business is not doing well, if we purchase their products or services, they will remain in their profession. You know, that is also important. So everything which we do should be, we should not create confusion, and we should support whoever is following the Varna. We should support them. I think that those are two things which we can do. And I think Sister Kalyani asked a question, you know, Ravana was a Brahmana, but he became a king because he wanted to, you know, rule. And that's why Rama is supposed to have, after killing him at the war, he had to do some Brahmahati dosha. Rights to overcome that because he killed a Brahmana, even though that Brahmana was not behaving like a Brahmana. So that's in the Ramayana. So the thing is, this type of confusion has always existed. Like Drona was a Brahmana, but he fought in the war. You know, things like that have happened. So there have been confusion among people, and even though they were born in a Varna, they practiced Nada Varna's Dharma. But what Swami says is, as much as possible for us, even in a state of confusion, we can stop creating more confusion. Because it's very difficult for us, ideally, because it's like, you know, when everything is such a hodgepodge, we are trying to find some order, it's impossible. As Sister Vijaya said, you know, we can't, you know, things are all in a confused state. So what we can do in this life, we are going to live in this confused Varna system, okay? But what Swami wants us is, I think somebody asked, Sister Anandi asked, why do we, because human greed is one. And second thing, I think our sister, sorry, Auntie Mani has already said, there is inferiority complex, superiority complex, thinking that I am in a lower, others are in a higher position. So we need to change the status quo, you know, things like that. I think ultimately, whatever we are doing, we should feel we are neither low nor high. I think that's important. We should be content with what we have. We should have the belief that Rama is look after us. We don't have to go and earn, you know, more and more, even if we are not paid well. He will make sure that we are looked after. I think, so those are things, and that's what Swami says, infuse morality, inner morality, constant attachment to truth, unperturbed equanimity of fortitude. If we can cultivate this, I think those are the three. Swami has given us the solution, how to survive through this confusion in us and around us. I think that's all I can say. If we go through this very successfully, I am sure we will be born in Bharat in a proper varna, and we will follow that in the next Janma. If I'm sure there may be a few, you know, or many who will attain liberation in this life, that's beside the point. But if you have to be born, we'll be born in a much more structured, stable varna system where we can pursue our spiritual sadhana. This is what actually Krishna is assuring Arjuna, that if you follow what I am telling, in the next birth, you will be born and to in a family, in a circumstances where you can continue your sadhana. So that he is assuring. I think Swami will speak about it in the Gita Vahini as well. So I will stop there. I hope I have addressed most of the questions to the best of my ability. The rest is up to Swami. I think we'll go back to, I think Varna, we have discussed enough, and I don't think we'll find more solutions. We'll go back to the Gita Vahini discussion, sisters. Yes, thank you. So here also in the last line, Swami is saying, hatred and rivalry in society are as harmful as the stoppage of work by all the limbs in anger against stomach. So we should not have hatred for somebody. You know, we should not feel jealous of somebody. We should not compete with somebody else in the society. If we avoid all this, Swami says, then everything should be fine. And that's what I understand. But I will open it up for any comments from other participants. Saira.
Saira, in the all the limbs are equivalent to all four varnas. What is equivalent to the stomach here?
So, sister, you know, I think, we are the limbs. The stomach, the heart, and everything is God. Because he's the one who processes and provides sustenance. So that's my understanding, but I will open it up for others to share their thoughts. Yes, Sister Vijaya, please go.
Sairam, that's a good question, Ananti, Sister Ananti. Because, you know, sometimes when you hear of strikes, and I don't know what they call in India, but, you know, they're going for strike. I have taken part in strike at the United Nations. Yeah. To ask for better treatment for HIV AIDS patients. So I brought all my kids, we all striked. In the end, I don't say it's because of that action, because the action was going off in so many countries. And this is for South Africa's Mbaki, President Mbaki was not giving any kind of treatment for a country that's the highest percentage of HIV AIDS patients in the world. So it's a, we felt it was a moral duty when you go on strike, or when you see the March for Women, you know, when they stop all work and they strike for some of President Trump's, things that he was doing. It's, I don't know how to answer this question. So, but they tried everything and nothing was working. And that's my perception. Maybe there are other things to try. But and actually the president of the organization was actually a sister from the physician from Anandapur College. So she was very passionate about this thing about why of all the ill education and lack of help, you know, for patients who are suffering so badly. And so hatred and rivalry as harmful as the stoppage of work. It's an interesting question, because sometimes when you stop the work, the factory or the people are taking a stand that, you know, if you don't, you know, for example, increase the salary or, you know, we're not going to work. I feel there's another way of approaching it, but sometimes they don't listen, you know? So it's not a right or wrong, good or bad, but each situation, you know, it's different. Sairam, thank you.
Sairam, sister.
Sairam, I think based on what Sister Vijaya said, I think, I don't know, this is my take on it. I guess it's the thought behind it or the reason behind it, I guess, matters more. Like, the, you know, you had a higher purpose for that, right? So it's not hatred and, you know, Auntie mentioned inferiority complex or superiority complex or anything of that sort here. So I guess that's where it matters. I don't know.
Any other thought, please? Anyone would just like to share? I think we will continue on. You know, I think we can, because there, I think ultimately each of us have to make our choices in how we, based on what we have understood, each of us in our own way. And basically the peace and happiness of society, as long as it's maintained, then we are okay. I think in the Dharma Vahini, Swami has said, the Lord also has a role to play. So I think if we depend on him more than what we can do to bring about change in society, then I think we are okay. That's all I could say, because sometimes we think we have to do something. When something is wrong, I think it has to be spoken. So people have to speak up. The people who are in a position to speak up should speak up. If the people who are not in a position to speak up, nothing is going to happen. Because that's unfortunately the situation, because there's more confusion coming out of it. And there's much suffering. Because we know all about protests, even in Canada. So in the past little while, all kinds of protests happen. Unfortunately, nothing, no good comes out of it. Even though what they intend to communicate may have been good, but overall, were they in the best position to speak up? You know, I think that's something which we have to all think. And sometimes the Lord will say, if it's not for you to do the job, you go and do your job well. Because you are neglecting your work, the world is at risk. So I think that's what Swami is saying. You know, even in the workplace, we can find, you know, sometimes if we are spending time on what others are not doing, we will be neglecting what we have to do. Because the time which we spent in thinking about what others is doing or one is not doing, that time we should have spent more profitably. And I think this way the rishis spend a lot of time praying. They felt prayer has better efficacy in bringing about change than human effort. So those are some thoughts I thought I would share. Yes, Brother Thasan, you would like to share.
Yes, Sairam, brother. Even though we're born in different varnas, to avoid that neither be low or high, if we think we are doing God's work, if we are not taking any fruit of the action, is nothing going to be affected. That's all I can say. Thank you, Saira.
Thank you very much, brother. Thank you. So I think maybe we will move on. I think we have discussed Varna for quite a bit of time in the last 2-3 weeks. 4 weeks, I guess, you know, 4 or 5 weeks. So there may be other things which we have to learn. So we will move on. As soon as we, okay.
A sugar doll is sweet all over. Break off its head and eat it. It is sweet. Break off its leg and eat it. It is sweet as the head. Then how can the varnas, which are the limbs of the self-same divinity, be pronounced higher or lower? Limbs are different, but the very same red blood flows in all and animates all. This is no special variety for the hand or a leg or face. The system of varna is ordained by the Vedas, and so there can be no injustice in it. It is not an artifice invented by man. But so those who try to create differences and hatred by their inconsiderate remarks about it are only exhibiting their ignorance. It looks as if those people who argue that the abolition of the Varna system will bring about human welfare are the only ones anxious to promote human welfare. They believe that those who consider the system to be beneficial are really eager to promote the downfall of the human society. Of course, both are delusions, but this much is true. Those who support the Varnas are really more interested in the promotion of human welfare. The others think that if Varna goes, they will be saving the country. That is the deluded belief. If only virtues and faults are analyzed carefully and without prejudice, there will be an end to the end of this uninformed campaign of hatred and enmity. Then there will be great change in attitude of people towards the Varna system.
Okay, thank you. Yes, Sister Vijaya, please.
You know, in India, for example, there are schools and education systems for people, the Harijans and the untouchables, to bring them up in society so that they have, with the benefit of a good education, they can, you know, help themselves. And we have this positive, positive affirmation in the universities and colleges to let people of the lower income group. The governments that have that positive way of thinking, as opposed to the downside of following the caste system that, you know, only the higher castes and those with money can go for higher education. It's no more the truth, I believe. More has to be done to educate more and more people, because then I said there's a great change in the attitude of people, even towards the Varna system, that you can come up with education no matter where you're born, you know. So there are steps that those of us who are in the position, we can take the steps. And for people who really want to get an education, I don't think anything can stop them. You know, it's also your will and your fight for your beliefs, and you know, you want to go further ahead. Sairam, I'm interested to see what everybody else has to say on this.
Sairam says, thank you. Anyone would like to comment? What was said and what Sister Vijaya shared. See, I can just see thinking something is high, something is low exists everywhere in the world. I work for a bank. The bank has, you know, 30,000-40,000 people working there. That the lower end people take home, I don't know, $40,000, $50,000. Whereas the people in the higher levels take home millions of dollars, millions. That's the caste system. They are taking money away from the organization which runs because of the people at the lower end. So this exploitation of people who, it becomes a club by itself. Exploitation is only in the human mind. Can we change? Can I change the bank system? Impossible. Even if I become the CEO, I cannot change it. Because the system of greed is so embedded. So the same problem has existed in India also, but it has nothing to do with the caste system or the varnas, which is what Swami is trying to say here. People have to do different jobs in the organization so that the organization can function. The teller, the branch managers, the approvers, the risk managers, the technology people, everyone has to do what they have to. If they don't do, and if everyone wants to be a CEO to make millions of dollars, the bank cannot function. So that's the reality in all parts of the world. But the thing is, sometimes we tend to blame it on the system. So can we say we want to abolish management, cadre, everyone has the same title. Everyone is a banker and they come to work and do all the things and take. It is not possible. The bank will not function. But the reality is exploitation is embedded in human mind only because of greed and selfishness. So the thing is that Swami is saying, address the problem, not the system. That is ultimately, can we change people? The thing is, untouchability has been existing always. Low caste, high caste have always existed. But then people of reformers also have existed always. Reform in India is not something new. Acceptance of everyone, every religion was there in India always. Which is in the modern day world, people call it secularism and all that. Every religious tradition has survived in India for centuries. Were there people ill-treating each other individually? Yes. But as a whole society, was not. So which Swami has spoken about quite a bit. Every single religion in this world exists in India. And their people are able to coexist, and they have coexisted for centuries. But people have fought with each other also because of, Swami will say, Arishad Varga, because of something wrong in your heart. So the solution lies in the heart, in each of us, in our own mind, fixing our mind rather than the system, which is why Swami is talking about it. But the problem is we try to throw the baby with the bath, they say bath water or whatever, So what is dirty and bad should be thrown out, and what is good within us has to be retained, then the system will function. And sometimes it's impossible to change the system in the world. Those are my thoughts. If we have to help somebody who is suffering, yes, we have to go about and help. And that's the nature, that's the Satya Sai organization. Swami says, wherever it's go, and if people are not educated, help them find education. If they need to be helped in any way so that they can look after themselves, go help. But the impact which each of us can do is only at a small level, to the close proximity around us, where we can have a good impact. We cannot solve macro problems. It's beyond us. I think that those are my thoughts. I will stop here. And okay, so yes, Sister Vijaya, please go ahead.
Your last comment, Brother Aruno. So I have a question. Swami says, the Kali Yuga, if you take it as a comparison, like the fan, at speed 5, it's going very, very fast. And he says that, when you're going into the Satya Yuga, right now we are already going into the Satya Yuga, it's coming down to zero, but it's not immediately going to stop. I'm looking up because I have a fan here. It's going to slow down. And right now we're in the transition phase of a slowing down into a whole new, what, the golden age, you know, it's already here, right? So I'm asking, this is a question, you know, out of all this readings and we have been doing, Swami, what does it take? What does it take, you know, we can be responsible for our own lives, our own dharma, you know, the Atma Dharma, the Kasta, everything, Varna Dharma, we can do it as to the best of our consciousness, the ability we have to understand Swami and to follow his precepts. But what does it take for the whole world to shift? What is Swami's thoughts on this? You know, we don't know, right? But he must have written down something. He says, should we just meander along this path, individual transformation, individual life, you know, and doing the best we can, doing the seva. But what does it take, Swami, to really uplift, especially in this world now? You know, your example of the bank is something, you know, you see the CEOs making millions of dollars and at buyouts. The government, us working class people have to pay the taxes and pay for these banks' buyout. You know, there's so much injustice. And Swami has said, injustice will continue. You know, but what are we supposed to feel? This injustice, you know, the wars with children, and he says, yes, continue with it. So, and we cannot look, what Krishna is saying is, you're not just the body, you are the Atma. Atma doesn't experience any death or grief or whatever. But so I think the Atma Dharma is the most important thing in here. But it's like, has Swami said anything? I said, you know, it's like you continue your way. You continue following this, what I tell you. Is that what the message is? Sairam, thank you.
Sairam, sister. See this, Swami has spoken about this yuga. You know, everyone talks, Jesus came 2000 years ago and said, golden age is at hand. So the question, many people will say, Jesus failed. What happened to the golden age? It never materialized for 2000 years, and we can't see it materializing for another 2000 years. See, we think, you know, we compartmentalize these yugas and think this yuga finishes, the next yuga starts. If that is so, why was Hiranyakashipu in Krita Yuga? People like Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha was just running riot. If you take Treta Yuga, Ravana was running riot. If you take Dwapara Yuga, Duryodhanas were running riot. The thing is, as long as human beings exist, this thing will coexist. But Swami says, you can choose in which Yuga you want to live. Swami says, if you take Krita Yuga, Prahlada was living in the Satya Yuga, whereas his father was living in Kali Yuga. So each of us have to choose in which yuga we are going to live. Whereas the problem is, we think the problem lays elsewhere. And if the world is, so the thing is, Swami says, don't worry about it. You just look at your transformation, and then whatever the circumstances, you will be in that yuga. But we unfortunately think the world is going to change. I mean, everyone in this world is going to change. When I cannot change, after reading so much and studying so much of Swami, then how can we expect the 6 billion people to also suddenly change overnight? So we think Satya Yoga comes, and then, you know, everyone will be smiling at each other, and, you know, everyone will be sad doing sadhana. I don't think that will happen ever. But each of us can have our own mini world where we can practice and we can be in Satya Yoga. And that is in each of our ability to do, and our own efforts determine that. That's my understanding. So I will ask others something, please share.
Sairam, see, there are two groups. One group supports the Varna system now in the present society. and the others think that Varna system goes away, then they'll be saving the country. Those who are supporting the Varna system, let me go back to the society where, you know, these lower caste people were not given enough opportunities to come up for the either for education or for their professions. So what happened, that was the system got into, they had a this thing of OBC, or that is backward class communities, and then the reserved seats were reserved, jobs were reserved for them, so that they also can come up and the society will feel equal. So they think that that group thinks we should support this Varna system. Swami said, those who support the Varnas are really more interested in the promotion of human welfare. They thought so. And the other group said, no, the Varna should go away so that the country will be saved. Because of this inequality, people thought, no, they were given, the lower caste were given more opportunities to come up. And those who are already really, they deserve, they are not being given proper places for them to work or for education. So these two groups, Swami is saying, both of them are in delusion. So it is really confusing how to contradict these two opinions into thing, and then what Sister Aruna was saying, to which Varna do we belong? To which caste we belong? It is really a question. And Swami says, you should follow the Karna Varna as far as possible, adhere to it. That's what Swami is saying. Sai Ram, that's all I can say.
Thank you, Aunty, thank you. Yes, Brother Thasan, you want to say something?
Okay, Sai Ram, brother. So we all know now Varna system was created by the God for some reason. So we had to follow that one. Even some group might say that Varna system is not important, we can have one Varna system. That means those people or fake people didn't understand whatever the God design is going to be collapsed. So people can make their own things, whatever, okay, brother said, yeah, even bank, if you take CEO and everyone, for a day, they make more than $50,000. So in America, they're more than that one. So they all come under the clubs. So even the CEO leave the company, it's not bank stocks or anything is not going to come down that much, because the banks maintain or run by so many directors, so many VPs and everything. So I'm not coming to that one. But the reality is, you came to this world alone. You have to know who you are, uplift yourself, and you have to merge with the divine. So you do your part. That is good. Whatever the Varna is. Thank you, Sai Ram.
Thank you, brother. Thank you.
Sai Ram, I also want to add one little point on this one. We always think world is leading to a bad situation or something. Why we should be thinking like that? Swami also said in some other in the discourses, what's in our mind, it would reflect when we look at others. If my mind always look at the good side or positive side, when I look at the world, I would think that, at least even if in this pandemic, this situation, the world survived and all the governments, in many different countries, they have tried their maximum, to bring into the current situation. And I should be thankful for those, the actions and those things. But if I think that, if my mind is, in the opposite situation, I would think that everything, the horrible, burned out, confused and this and that. So Swami, clearly said, we cannot change the world. We can only change ourselves. This would bring the change in the world. The inner meaning is that when we change ourselves, whatever we look, it would look on, we will look only the positive side of the world. Then we will be happy and content. That's my little point here. Thank you, Sairam.
Thank you, Sister Anandi. And Sister Kalyani also has posted the same thought from Satya Sai Speaks. Swami says, I have come across people who recite a prayer and believe that they are bringing the world nearer to peace with every occasion on which they pray. But peace can be won only the hard way by eliminating violence and greed from the hearts of individuals. I think, you know, this when Swami is talking about delusion, I don't know whether Swami is talking that an individual can bring about promote human welfare, you know, if that's a delusion, or, you know, or the method by which we are going to achieve that is a delusion. We ultimately, I think God is the one who is capable of bringing about human welfare. We can only do our small pittance of thing, you know, very small, almost negligible, insignificant contribution. That's my thought. Okay.
Brother, changing ourselves on the right way, that's the biggest thing. I look at it.
Yeah.
You change. Then it's a bigger change you are making to the society. Thank you, Sarah. Yeah.
So if there are no other thoughts, maybe we will just go to the next slide. Okay.
If the goal is,
Yes, Andy, go ahead.
If the goal, human goal, is to achieve a good society with equanimity in the society, as you said, each one of us can contribute in our own way by changing ourselves so that the human society becomes now. Without any Varna system or without any hatred, without any rivalry, it can become, to a great extent, peace can prevail. That's what I also feel. Thank you, Saira.
Thank you, Auntie. I think Sister Narmada, yeah, you can read. But yes, Sister Vijaya.
Saira, Mani Auntie, you just raised a very good point. You know, I think all of us, you know, with the prasad of Swami's, you know, study circles and education with him and all these years, you know, hearing his message, I think the greatest thing we can do when we look at the greed and, you know, everything in people, that, you know, you have to consider more than 60, 70, 80, 90% of humanity, they have no clue. Like, I don't even have to think about that. I just think about myself, even when I have every luxury, every education, everything I had, how little I understood about life and how little I understood about what is the most important thing of life, you know, the divine and how to serve and, there are many people who are suffering from that. So my sense is we all have to go out and, you know, we can live our life with our neighbors and our family and not worry so much. Swami says, be in equanimity. Don't worry what they will say. So, you know, for those of us who, I wanted to study this EduCare for a long time. You know, I think it was in California or somewhere they in Santa Barbara. And I was thinking, this is such a good program to bring to schools and, you know, to talk about with teachers. And I know when Mani Auntie was in Boston with us, you know, my kids, you know, we benefited so much. So first time they were coming there for the SSV class, the Satya Sai Education in Human Values. You know, it was such an honor and such a privilege, you know. It's when you think of yourself at the receiving end, I think if all of us, for example, in this group, you know, 18 people here, you know, and I know many of us are already doing it, preaching to the choir, but, you know, to think about ourselves when we were in ignorance and somebody came and told us about Swami or, you know, repeatedly. So not to worry whether they come to the fold or whatever they're doing, whether they're changing their greed. But as an example, we can stand up And where there is an opportunity, we can teach. And I say that with a lot of sadness, because in my community here, you know, I started this free meditation class and they looked at me and said, why are you so stupid? You are so trained, you should be charging. And I said, no, I don't want to charge this. You know, they don't even know themselves. You know, that is to me like, wow. You know, there are people who don't know how to go in. They don't know the joy of bhajans. They don't know the joy of namasmarana. You know, I can talk about it. I'm passionate about it. And sometimes only one person will turn up. Two persons out of thousands of people here. One or two people. I say, Swami, it's your business. You are running the show. I'm continuing to do it. So it's very hard to do it. I'm not saying it's easy, you know, but I think we have to consider too our role in helping our fellow people and remembering we were also at one stage, you know, wherever we were. And there are many people who benefit. You don't even know. Swami knows, because I know many, many years later, people will come and contact me and say, oh, I went for your class. You remember that my whole life, my family's life, everything changed, you know? So Swami is a doer. We are not, but we can step up to the plate and, you know, give what we are good at. We could be cooking class, but we can put human values in the cooking class, you know, or sewing class, you know, it doesn't matter what it is, but we will speak up for the human values. And we're thinking of Swami, we're not saying his name, you know, but we can do it, you know, it's not impossible. Sairam, thank you.
Sairam, sister, thank you. So we can just read. I think we have 8 minutes.
Okay, interesting. If hatred increases, it will not benefit anyone. To pursue the ideal of all are equal is like running after the mirage to slake one's thirst. It will only breed discontent. The rulers must now assemble and consult their representatives of the people, namely the pundits and experienced elders, and discuss the value of this ancient system of social organization. Instead, if they just decide on the basis of external forms and features that there is some poison in this and run into panic, that will only reveal the ignorance. The rulers as well as the pundits both have the happiness of the people at heart. Why this Varna system originated and with what end in view had led to comments because it was not practiced on the continued councils of the wise. Take one small example. Some nations have manufactured bombs that can wipe out lakhs, hundred thousands of people at one burst. Though they know this is bad, the rulers are themselves encouraging it. If they are used as the whim takes them, ruin will fall on all. When chaos threatens, they are to be used only for self-defense. The purpose is not the destruction of the world, but the protection of the values of the one's own country and culture. So also the Varna system is to be treated as strong armament to protect country and culture. The rules and regulations, the restrictions and recommendations are all to defend the people from ruin. They are disciplines which have to be honored in the way they are laid down and followed strictly and correctly. To deal with them as the whim dictates, without regard to the directing bonds, the limits and the boundaries, is to invite anarchy.
Thank you, sister. I think we will not take it up for discussion because it's already 4:24. But I think everyone can read, digest, think, contemplate, and we can continue the discussion next week. So those are my words. If there's anything anyone would like to share, not related to this, what we read, but anything else which we discussed today, please take the opportunity to say. Otherwise, we will close the session with Samasta Loka and Shanti. Okay, I think there's enough food for thought. So we will pause here and we'll continue our study circle next Sunday. Saiva. Om Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu. Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu. Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Sai Ram.
Sai Ram, brother.
Sai Ram, thank you so much.
Thank you, Sai Ram.
Thank you.